name's Ian Watson, and I'm the Artistic Director of the Connecticut Early Music Festival. A very warm welcome to our 2021 online virtual festival, and particularly to this concert from the George Kent Concert Hall in Westerly, Rhode Island. If you haven't seen our other two concerts, I encourage you to do so. Beautiful video from Les Delices, which was rescheduled from last year, and another one from the Custom House Maritime Museum, Sea Interludes. Today's concert is called The Italian Connection, and it's basically music by Vivaldi and Bach. Although Bach remained in a very small geographical area for all of his life, he was very familiar with other people's music from other countries. Of course, he wrote the English suites, the French suites, the Italian concerto. So he was very well versed in various styles, particularly Italian music. The Italians, especially Vivaldi, had managed to have their music published all over Europe. And I think Bach was particularly drawn to Vivaldi, maybe for the colorful Mediterranean energy. So much so that he transcribed Vivaldi violin concertos for organ, and also famously the Vivaldi four violin concerto for four harpsichords. So I hope you enjoy our mix of Vivaldi and Bach. There are some virtuoso displays from my friends Aislinn and Guy. Very much hope you enjoy the concert. Thank you. So I'd like to welcome Andrew Howell to our online concert. Andrew is the music director of the Chorus of Westerly, and he's going to tell us about the work that they do and about this extraordinary building that we're sitting in. Welcome, Andrew. It's wonderful to be here.
Thank you.
Is this where you rehearse and perform?
So this is our home here in Westerly, Rhode Island. It's where we've been since the 1960s. Thankfully, our forebears saw the value in this space when it had been kind of left by the Catholic Church and moved down the street. They built a new space that was bigger. And thankfully, somehow, our founding director, George Kent, got in here and ran a concert, realized how amazing the acoustics were, and the building was purchased and became our home.
Wow.
So we've been very lucky to be able to kind of take a lot of chances and do a lot of exciting things in this space over the years. It's where, in a normal season, when we're not surrounded by COVID, we are rehearsing eight rehearsals a week here over most weekdays. We've got about 180 children and adults who come in these doors every week and get about 2 hours of rehearsal.
Wow.
We're putting on a full season of classical and pops concerts, bringing in guest artists and trying to use the space as much as possible.
Right. But not doing very much then.
Yeah, exactly. And,
so when did the organization begin? You mentioned George Kent.
Yeah, so the Chorus of Westerly itself began as a little bit of a community outreach expansion of the Christ Church, Episcopal Church, across town in Westerly in 1959, and it was the community chorus, the concert chorus of Christ Church, and then quickly took flight on its own, became a 501c3 nonprofit, and expanded into what it is today. For a while, they hopped around to Stonington High School and some other places for venues.
I see.
But when they ended up in here, this became the place for us.
And when did you take over as music director?
I started in 2014. You'd think I would know that. Yes, something like that. Yeah.
Right.
After George Kent had run the chorus for 53 years, the founding director had stayed around for all of that time, doing tremendous work. And I happened to be one of the kids who grew up through the program.
Right.
Started singing as a 13-year-old, and
That's
continued true. Through the program, went off to school, and then came back, and now I'm in my dream job. So I'm very happy to be the second.
No, I was talking to Harvey Blanchett, who's been helping us today, and he was saying that he's about the third generation chorister. That his whole family, his parents, his grandparents, they were all involved in the West. That's so wonderful.
Yeah, my wife is actually his cousin.
So oh, is that right?
Third generation. Yeah, it's
how about that?
It mixed there. Yeah.
Yeah. So are there many of those sort of multi-generational choristers? I mean, who are kind of trained in the system, as it were.
Absolutely, and that's one of the keys of who we've been since the beginning, is that we have a mixture of adults and children getting together and singing these choral orchestral masterworks and working together on these enormous projects. That was one of the founding concepts that George Kent went in with.
What an amazing achievement.
Yeah.
And so extraordinary. I'm grateful for you carrying on the good work.
I'm happy to be able to do it.
Yeah. I mean, it's a really unique organization in the country. It has to be.
Yeah, it is.
So anyway, we're absolutely delighted to be here, and thank you very much indeed for joining me and
my pleasure.
Telling me about all your activities.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, Ian.
Hello, my name is Guy Fishman. Thank you for joining us for this concert. Johann Sebastian Bach's entire life spanned the majority of Germany's attempt to reconstruct itself after the devastation of the Hundred Years' War, in trying to gain some level of control over their lives after their world was almost destroyed. Germans looked to the art of rhetoric, fencing, music, painting, and dance, and not just any dance, but French court dancing, stylized dancing. And so it's no surprise that during Bach's life, the dance suite was one of the most popular musical forms. It was only replaced by the symphony after Bach's death. A dance suite contains a prelude, typically, and then French court dances. And in the case of this suite in G major for unaccompanied cello written in 1720, almost all of the dances are archaic. They were not danced to during Bach's life. We begin with an allemande, which is a French dance describing Germans dancing. This is written by a German composer, so back and forth. It's followed by a courant, which is actually a corrente, a fast Italian dance. Then a saraband, which is like the emotional center of the suite and has its origins in South America. Then follow two minuets, which were popular dances during Bach's life. And we finish with a gigue, a sort of happy farmer dance. This suite was written at a time when the cello was just emerging as a potential purveyor of virtuoso music. That was usually left to the violin. So Bach certainly gifted us six masterworks in these suites for unaccompanied cello at a time where he had no real reason to do so. And we enjoy them to this day, as I hope you will enjoy this performance.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.